The building, as I mentioned, is self-contained. It doesn't produce any side or harmful effects at all. There's no water or sewage required. The building also does not, it's not a manned building. Site visits by our technicians might be to the tune of once a month, except during the actual planning and developmental process of the building itself. The total site that we're looking at is about 100 by 100 square feet, 100 by 100 feet. And the site itself already has three communications towers, and what we're planning to do is add a fourth one in that same general area. It's about 350 feet away from them. Traffic to the site itself, like I mentioned, would be one, maybe two visits a month, and should have no harmful effects on the environment. The site that we would plan to locate the tower is on a level area. There's no wetlands that we could see, as we've walked that area several times over the last couple of months. And as far as people using the building, again, I mentioned that it's self-contained. Any alarms, fire alarms, communications alarms are self-contained and would automatically dial up to our main site to alert us of any problems. The reason for the request to build a communications tower in Cape Elizabeth is for coverage. As a publicly mandated utility, we are regulated both by the Public Utilities Commission of the State of Maine and the Federal Communications Commission. And as such, one of our mandates is to provide adequate cellular communication service within the three counties that we serve within 3 years. And we've been up and running for just 1 year, and this would bring service out into the Cape Elizabeth area would provide substantially better coverage for existing customers and future customers of the service. I think you have on record a letter from Dr. D'Angelo, who is a resident of Cape Elizabeth, and he's spoken to me on several occasions of instances where he has been on call and asked to go into the hospital for emergency service at night, and when he gets the call, he tends to use his cellular telephone in the car as he's driving to the hospital and getting vital information both on the patient's status and telling people to administer various medications. And there are places and times where those calls are cut off. That's one of the reasons why we're looking to improve service. Thank you.
Thank you. Could we have a comments on staff review?
Sure. As always, application completeness. But before that, I'd like to talk a little bit about the process and where we are now and where the board's probably going to be going. We don't have or didn't have minutes, though it sounds like we have them this evening. We didn't have minutes from the Board of Zoning Appeals meeting regarding this tower. But in essence, as far as I understand, the Board of Zoning Appeals, when they looked at this, the tower was going to be located in a slightly different spot. And looking at the current Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance, they interpreted it to read that these towers were a type of public utility and therefore weren't permitted in the Residence A district. And upon further review of the ordinance, they felt that the only district that a tower such as this would be allowed would be in the Resource Protection District, because under there they talk about essential services such as, they don't mention telecommunications towers directly, but they felt that that was the only closest reference they could find. So, and with that being stated and interpreted, that's where it is now before you. The situation is, however, as far as I can tell, I tried to find time in my schedule, and it was just a busy week, to meet with Mr. Strout to take a look at the site itself, and that's something I think the board will want to do. From what I understand, it appears that this Resource Protection District is actually due, the designation is due to a mapping error, and that there, from it appears to be, and it's from, it sounds like there's allegedly no resource protection characteristics on the site. So, and for that, from that basis, it appears as though this location may not be as negative as it would first appear when you hear about a tower being put in a resource protection district, which normally would be considered close to taboo, at least in this town. that's something I think we need to verify a little more carefully than with on-site inspections, with other materials that are submitted, just to make sure that that's absolutely clear. That's where it is at this point. There's application completeness, site plan review, and because it is in a mapped resource protection district, conditions being there or not, it does have to go through the permit process where they have to receive a planning board permit for construction in a resource protection district. So that's another process that would have to go through, and they did submit some materials that address some of those concerns that are located. There's 8 to 10 criteria that the board has to find will not be, will be met before you can grant that approval. So you're really doing two sorts of approval processes.
The first issue, application completeness, could you take us through the list? There are some question marks, there are
sure.
some partials.
Yep.
See where we stand on that.
Okay. They're close. The lot line dimension issue, not there. Lot's relatively apparent, but the actual dimensions aren't on the site plan. Location of existing buildings and structures, adjacent structures on the adjacent lots are not shown themselves. Some are on the site, but adjacent lots, they're not. That's 5A. 5C, location of easements, unclear whether or not there are any. I assume there's some sort of agreement that allows the use of the paved private driveway to get to the existing towers. Has to be cleared up. Location of driveways, again, dealt with the abutting properties in terms of where their driveways are located. I just want to point out that that's an important issue. I think it'll be important for the board to know where all the driveways are, because you'll find, if and when you go on a site walk, that we're dealing with a substantial site distance issue. Looking south on Spurwick Avenue, you're looking up to a rise and then it drops off. So that's an issue that needs to be dealt with. And so that's why some of these items are important in this case. Building setbacks, side yard, rear yard, alluded to, but not really shown. Existing physical features, not shown all that much. Some, but not all. Topography, not shown. That might be important if you need that to back up what you saw in the field in terms of elevations and the like. Parking, loading, and unloading locations actually should be a partial in terms of some of the site plan. It's there. That may not be a big issue, especially since you're not talking about a lot of traffic going to and from. I think the turnaround area may be a slight problem. Curb information, if any is required, hasn't been supplied. Drainage issues, stormwater management, nothing supplied, not sure if that is an issue. Landscaping and buffering, nothing's applied. Again, the existing vegetation may do it, may not. And evidence of right title and interest, not been supplied.
There are some substantial items missing from this list. There's one other item which I noted on my ride home tonight, because I live off Scott Dyer Road, and I wanted a site where this would be. It'll be very helpful, I know, to me if maybe it comes under landscaping and buffering plan. It'd be awful hard to buffer a 180-foot tower. But it might be very helpful if, hopefully this request is not aligned, to have some photographs shown of the existing towers and what the new tower might look like, if it's possible to sketch it in or use a grease pencil or something to show what the effect would be on that view. It may be important for people to realize that. You may not get that from a site visit, but a photograph might show it.
We've taken a few photographs of the existing towers, and they don't even show up on the photographs we've taken. They're gray, and as the new tower would be also, and it's almost naked to the human eye unless you know where you're looking to actually see the darn thing. But we'd be glad to take pictures and have them blown up.
Yeah, I didn't have any problem picking it out when I looked at it. Anyways, that would just be a comment. Well, I guess we should first of all address the issue of completeness. Any comments from the board on that? You've heard our staff comment. Mr.
Mr. Chairman, just a couple of comments. I was waiting for Steve to say something else. I read the minutes from the Board of Appeals, or maybe it was an article in the paper the next day, but I think it was a minute.
We have them here.
Okay. The concern that was expressed by the Board of Appeals dealt mainly in precedent for potential for location of towers in other residential areas. And there are a lot of issues. I guess I say that preceding the other comments, there are a lot of issues that are not complete on the site plan application. But this isn't a typical site plan application either, perhaps. It's a different type of use. It's a different type of facility. It's a different type of issue than we normally face. There may be some issues of substance, such as right, title, and interest. The application is being proposed by one party, and yet it's on another party's land. Those parties are in attendance this evening who own the land. And I'm not sure how big an issue that is in terms of application completeness. It may be, I mean, it has been when we deal with subdivisions and other site plans where there are problems that potentially could arise. There are easement agreements and things of that nature that are of concern as well. But I guess, at least from one member of the planning board, there are not a lot of technical issues that I feel constrained to vote against an issue like this. In fact, I'm more oriented towards voting for an application like this with the completion of all of the issues, all of the T's being crossed and the I's dotted for our ordinance process, which I think is very important too. I guess the conclusion of what I'm attempting to say is that I would like to see the application proceed. I don't think we can approve it tonight, obviously. But I'm wondering if there's anything that we can do over the next 30 days until our next meeting while the applicant is pulling together all of the information so that we can go look at the site, even though we don't have an application complete, so that we can look at the site, which is one of the stumbling blocks that we have in site plan review. We really should go look at the proposed use and maybe look at where it's supposed to go from afar and try to visualize what a 180-foot tower is with the other towers that are existing there as well. So I would propose that though this application is not complete and perhaps we cannot deem it complete tonight, that we do set a site walk if we can do that, and that we direct our staff to work with the applicant to make sure that the application is complete with all of the technical issues for the next meeting so that action can be taken in June.
I think that's a good proposal and certainly would help move things along. We don't like to work with incomplete applications either. It just means we have to look at it more times than we prefer to, frankly. There's been a suggestion that we have a site walk in advance of deeming the application complete. We do have some notes here from the zoning board minutes. Maybe I could ask the secretary to read them. It might be interesting just to give us a view of what that board considered important on this application.
Yeah, I think Mr. Tinsman did get the right feeling from either the minutes or the newspaper, whatever, that the board was more concerned about setting a precedent in other areas, and this was taken up as being considered an RA zone. The main feeling was that it was a good location, but it was too long a stretch to fit within the RA zone ordinance rules, and they would prefer to get the ordinance changed, and they did in fact recommend that it go to the town council to be addressed as having the ordinance changed in order to take care of this. It was considered by three of the members as an essential service and five of them to feel that it was a utility, just in a vote as to whether they felt it was a necessary service or not. They all did agree that it was a needed service, just not within that zone, and therefore they wanted someone else to act on it.
Mr. Chairman, to follow up on that, the the zoning board chair did write a letter to the town council asking that the zoning ordinance be considered to be amended to allow these sorts of uses where appropriate.
I share some of the same views as Dick, because you have to put it in perspective. It's a public utility in an area, and I've driven by there a number of times, of other towers. I'm not convinced anybody would even notice it from the road if there was one more thing sticking up that you can hardly see. I was surprised. I don't know whether your tower will be substantially larger than the ones that are there now, but I was surprised at how invisible they are. So I guess my sense is that if we treat this like something that's a commercial activity that's going to be built anew, and we worry it to death, we may be doing a disservice to the people who rely on the service. That's not to say that we have enough to go ahead on today, but I do think we got to keep in perspective, and it probably would help people to see the site fairly quickly so they get a sense of the mini communications conglomerate area that we're going to have in the Cape. I say that half tongue-in-cheek. I think it's a good idea to put these kinds of things in locations where apparently the owners or the other people aren't concerned. It's the type of thing that ought to go in an area where there are others and there's no concern. So I'd like to move it along also.
There will be some dishes on the top of this tower, won't there, or partially the way up?
Not initially. What we're planning to do, the top of the tower would actually have what we call a whip. What's the word, Jack? Help me out. A whip. Yeah. They're just four foot whips that are the communications towers. We don't have any plans for at least the next 3 years to put a communications dish up. Our communications link back to New England Telephone would be through leased lines until such point as New England Telephone's rates, either if they stabilize, we'd stay that way. If they raise the rates to the point where it was more economical for us to put up our own microwave, we consider doing it at some point. But the economic analysis that we've done shows that at least for the first 3 to 5 years, it's less expensive for us to lease the line mm-hmm. back to New England Telephone for the control purposes. So that you'd see these whips up there. You'd really have to squint to see those.
Okay. There has been an informal suggestion.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair. Yeah. Does this at all interfere or come under the purview of the FAA?
Not where that location is.
Is that low enough or out of the traffic?
The traffic coming into the airport, yeah.
It's not low enough, right, because 180 foot would be a problem in an airport area, wouldn't it?
Before we get to the point of looking at optimum sites, one of our engineering firms takes into account where those sites are and adjacent to the takeoff and landing runways of adjacent airports, and they came back to us and said that that site and that height would not be an interference with the FAA.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's been an informal suggestion that we schedule a site visit in advance of the application completeness issue being settled. I don't have a problem with that. We just have a problem with dates. I think the 24th of May is filled. I don't think we're going to be right out of light. We're at 6:30. So what other dates would be acceptable? It wouldn't have to be a long visit, but I guess weekends are out, so we're into the week. Yeah, before that.
Yeah. How about the next night, Thursday the 25th?
Want to try to do it 2 nights in a row?
I might have some problems that night.
Okay. What about going to the next week? Tuesday or Wednesday? Tuesday or Wednesday the next week? 30.
Yes. Wednesday's all right. I can't Tuesday.
Wednesday the 31st?
Yep.
Let's set it for that. I will be out of town, but that shouldn't be.
5:30.
Fine. I'm not going to be there. I'll go look myself on my way home. I'll drive up there.
Can you drive right down here?
Yeah.
Can you get in?
Mr. Strzok could probably give better directions than me, but his driveway goes past his house, and from there you can walk down the path that we plan to widen up and expand to the site.
Okay. Well,
there's some blackberry bushes there, so I wouldn't wear good suits.
Okay. I'll try to get in there sometime, either before or after.
Mr.
Mr. Chairman, just a question. If height's a concern, would it make sense, and it has been done in other instances, would it make sense for them to fly a balloon, helium-filled balloon, large one that would be 180 feet above, so you could see on-site as well as from a distance, you know, roughly what you're looking at?
That would be a good idea.
I think so.
There's existing towers there that you could reference off on. There's a 140-foot tower there now.
I think it would be good, helpful to have that in perspective, too, of helium-filled balloon.
I can get a balloon.
Yeah. I think, you know, I don't know big where. Enough so you can see it from the ground.
There must be a carnival somewhere in town.
Pardon?
Yep.
I'm sorry, sir.
Yep.
So that would give you the additional 40 feet. Mm-hmm. As I recall, the new towers would be built on a lower starting point than the existing towers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why initially... the original site, there was some flexibility in the height. We were willing to go down to 150 or 140 feet. Now we're looking in the RP zone, and you'll see when you go there, it is downhill a bit from where the other three are. So the net effect should be about the same as the existing 140.
So the height will be about the same as 140 foot when you get through. That's interesting. Okay. Well, the balloon is a good idea. Let's give us a reference. Do we have anything more of this applicant at this time? You know, we don't have an application complete. I don't think there's really any issue going to a vote on site plan review or resource protection. I think we'd have to wait till next time on those.
I just have a personal question. Is this, I can't for the life of me visualize what this thing looks like.
I'm sorry?
I can't visualize what it looks like.
A tower?
I mean, I've got a picture, and they probably are invisible, and I've seen them but not noticed it. Do they look like the towers that are going to be there? Is it the same sort of tower?
No, the three towers that are there now are what we call supported towers. They're guide towers, thank you.
And they look like the tower that's down near Super Shop and Save, the WPOR tower.
Similar to that. Like ours is wider at the base because it's self-supporting. If you look at the base, it's triangular, and each of the three sides are 21 feet in length. And as it gets taller, it comes up sort of like the Eiffel Tower. The smaller it gets at the top.
I have a suggestion.
Yeah.
If you're familiar with where the state police facility is in Scarborough, there's one right behind it.
Okay.
However, it is shorter than the one you proposed.
Right.
But it
looks like. Well, that was my next question. Where can I see one of these things? That's the state police office.
We've got one up in Gray, one in Auburn. The one that's in Portland is, we're actually renting space on a tower that's substantially higher than that.
Mm-hmm.
And the same with the one up in West Bath and Freeport. So the two that would be identical to the one we're looking at would be either in Auburn or Gray.
No, I'm just in my own mind.
Yeah. And it's a gray tower that, as it ages, you know, turns grayer and becomes, you know, especially to the blue skyline, almost invisible, unless you're really looking for where it is. And there's no lights on it.
That was my next question. Mm-hmm. Are there lights blinking?
No. There is on the Auburn Tower because that's in the same general area of the Auburn Airport.
Okay.
Are there any other questions of this applicant?
Mr. Chairman, only that June 2nd is when the application is closed for our next meeting.
That's correct.
All data would have to be done by then.
So we would be working with Mr. Butler to refine all that.
Right. And our visit would be before that.
Would you like us to be there that evening of the visit?
I think it would be helpful.
Okay. It's 5:30 on the 21st.
31st.
Glad I asked.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As I see the agenda, we have only to set a date for a workshop. It's the only item left on our business for tonight. Is there anything else, Steve?
There's one other item along with that. It's I did talk to Marion Guthrie, who couldn't be here, and she also received communications from the Fort Williams Advisory Committee inviting the planning board on some sort of site visit of the fort. They suggested sometime during the month of June. I think they're flexible, but they'd like to at some point discuss what they see as being the future needs and the future plans and want to bounce it off the planning board. So that's another item.
Well, could we, we normally would have a workshop on the 6th. Would it make any sense for us to have a site walk at Fort Williams on the 6th and come back for a planning board workshop and not have another day? We have two meetings a month for that reason. My proposal would be that we have a site walk on maybe at 6:30 and come back for a 7:30 workshop meeting.
The Fort Williams Advisory Committee may wish to sit with the planning board to talk about items of interest to them, and it may take up a whole evening, but maybe, unless there's something else scheduled for that night, maybe that could be the topic of the workshop meeting.
Did you have something else, Steve?
Marion has suggested, actually, a couple other items maybe could be incorporated in. She wanted to get back to the daycare issue. And wanted to, we talked about getting back together and forming some, or having a meeting with the zoning board, who actually originated that whole topic, if you remember, as well as with other boards, and then perhaps also getting an update in terms of the wetlands ordinance. Those are the two items that Marion, you know, and I had talked about, but it's open.
I tend to agree with Dick. If we're going to have a workshop, it's best not to really try to combine a lot of issues unless they're urgently needed. My preference would be to keep it to a single issue item and cover it in enough detail to make it worthwhile. So my thought would be we tour Fort Williams, come back and have a meeting with the Fort Williams Advisory Committee and settle those issues, and that would be it for the evening.
I think that's a wonderful idea.
I think that's
idea.
Enough yeah. to discuss in that one topic.
Is there anything brewing? Is there information?
Yeah, is there a change going to be occurring there? Is that where they want us to go?
That I don't know. I haven't seen the letter. I just... Yeah.
I would note that I won't be here that night. I'll be driving from Ohio with my daughter.
I have a point of discussion that I'd like to bring up. I had a call after this last wet spell in regards to our road going into the Little Dyer Pond. I think... there was a lot of concern expressed about the relationship of the 24-hour storm basis being used and the 24-year or 25-year storm basis data being used to determine flooding and runoff. And I think maybe this last storm, as I rode by on Shore Road several times, rode through water.
It was blocked.
It had overtopped the road. Yeah. It did not seem to me that this was a 100-year storm or indeed even a 25-year storm, that it might be common enough to have taken place even once every 2 years, once every year.
This last storm.
Well,
but it's not a 100-year storm.
It's not a 100-year storm, nor is it.
It took a couple of days.
It was a 5-inch storm.
That's a 25-year storm.
But that's what they call a 25-year storm.
Yes.
However, does that, I guess that what I'm suggesting is, do we need to review what our engineers are using as a basis to evaluate our flooding situation? And the other issue that was brought up, of course, was, is that road that's being, and we can't do anything about it, I suppose now, is that road, which was certainly well flooded, that's proposed to go into Little Dyer Pond, the best place, or should it be up?
In anticipation of that discussion, one thing that might be interesting is to see whether there are some other accepted design standards. I know the 24-hour and 25-year are sort of what you always get thrown back, and I don't know whether it's kind of like our subsurface disposal ordinance. It's just kind of middle of the road that could be a lot stricter, or whether it's state-of-the-art and it would be fools to ask for anything more. It'd be interesting to know whether there's some more modern set of numbers that people are using that we ought to instruct our engineer to
use. Sure.
Steve, could you take some of those issues under advisement? Maybe give us a short report back at the next meeting or in the workshop if you can get it done by that time, otherwise the 20th.
I would think that an excellent place to be talking about that is in our wetlands ordinance as well. I mean, that's the direct correlation or relationship. although it's a stormwater issue. And I would like to see whether there's another standard, too, for a 50-year storm or a 35-year storm, to see how we're moving.
I know at some point we talked about going to use 100 and also a 2-year storm, because there are different flooding characteristics that happen even with a small amount of a rainfall, and then the 100-year, of course, is there.
But the reality of, for example, that place on Shore Road is that it has been overtopped many times within the last 5 or 6 years.
The other issue with respect to that whole issue is just what to do with conditions that are already flooded. I mean, but the thing that has to be pointed out is that that's probably not due to Stonegate, I'm guessing.
Right.
And it's, so it's existing, and right now the board pretty much deals with trying to keep things at pre-development conditions. And what you've been seeing are pre-development conditions. And, does the town need to take a more advanced or more progressive sort of stance?
Or a more careful look at other alternatives for siting?
There's also the outside chance that the development will improve the situation. I'm not suggesting that it will, but it's a possibility. Because what we have right now is not good.
Well, I would like to suggest that we do have a workshop on this. Maybe it can be done in relationship to the wetlands ordinance, although I don't think the new wetlands ordinance specifically addresses that. So
I'll have Bob Hunter do some look. I'll do some research on my own and see what we come up with. I think at the next workshop, I can give you some initial findings. It's not going to be the end-all report, but it's a good topic to look at.
I agree.
Any other issues?
Mr. Chairman, just going back to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee Planning Board joint meeting, presumably the 6th will be acceptable to the Fort Williams Advisory Committee. And if it is, maybe we could ask Steve to prepare a 5 or 10 minute discussion on the Greenbelt program and where we sit with that, since one of the terminal points is Fort Williams and something we're orienting towards, and it might be good for us to have their perspective of what we're attempting to do with our Greenbelt program in part centering on Fort Williams.
It would also be helpful to have those maps available that evening.
Ivan, you mentioned 6:30 to site. Do you want to still stick with that, or do you want to do 7 on site and then come back here?
7 o'clock will probably be too dark.
Okay.
6:30. So any other business to come before the board? Not entertain a motion to adjourn. Second? Thank you.
With a loan. 27 minutes past the hour, Shannon Smith enjoying the night with you.
Presenting the many refreshing ways America takes the nasty plunge. There's the everyone into the pool plunge.
Roll, everybody
in. The I'm not sure what you think about it plunge.